for the introduction, and thanks so much to the Ford Family Foundation for bringing me here. I'm on day 4 of my whirlwind tour, and I've seen so many studios and had so many great conversations, and I have 3 more days to go, and it just feels like you get really excited about meeting these people that you just would not have the opportunity to do otherwise. So this has been a really special trip for me. So I wanted to say that from the outset. You know, as you learned in the introduction, I founded a blog called Art F City. For the people who know of the blog, when it was first founded, it went by a different name, Art Fag City. So we went through a name change at one point, which I'll get to, but basically the name was sort of used in the same way that you might use like Opera Queen, which is to mean something, a blog that came to art and writers who came to art with effusive fandom for it. And I felt that being based in New York City gave me a good opportunity to really engage with a lot of art. So that's sort of where that came from. But I founded the blog in 2005, so that's 13 years ago, and that was as a single art author art blog, and now it's a nonprofit. And we look specifically at the intersection of art, politics, and money. So I'm going to start, pre-blog. So this is pre-Arts, pre-Art F City. Welcome to the 1990s. So that's amazing, right? That's the 1990s in a nutshell. As you heard, that was like Patrick Stewart as Captain Jean-Luc Picard. He is, you know, on a mission of discovery. And at the time of its airing, I think, you know, the Star Trek franchise was at its height. You know, they had Voyager. They had Deep Space Nine, they had Next Generation, which you just saw. The new Star Wars, those things were, the prequels had been announced. The X-Files, this was all about like outer space, like weird phenomenon, that sort of thing. So all of which to say that space at that time was very much on the minds of Americans. And let's see, I gotta get to the next slide. Here we go. So it's no surprise then, that's the Netscape Navigator animated GIF. That was their logo. And there's another one that appeared. This one appeared in 1994, I think, 1995. They actually had a ship's wheel. So the idea that, like, you know, the first internet browser... Well, first of all, that the first internet browser had integrated space into its logo was not an accident. It was already in the cultural lexicon, so of course they used that. But also, you know, it was a very good metaphor for how the internet was a land to discover. So that was in 1995. And then 10 years later, when I started Art F City, that sense of newness and discovery still hadn't worn off. So we'd stopped using space as a metaphor for everything internet related, But like those on the Starship, we were networked. And I, for one, was very excited about the possibilities of online life. So I started AFC because I believed what was like a very popular narrative at the time. And one that I think is, continued to this day by Mark Zuckerberg, that the internet connects us, that we, you know, the web in some ways like democratizes content, and that anybody can be a critic. And if I didn't believe in that, I don't think I would have started Art of City to begin with, because I went to art school. You know, I had a background in painting and sound art, and I really did not think of myself as a writer, and I had a lot of anxiety about writing, in fact. But this was like a kind of freedom. Like, you could express yourself, and maybe you'd be bad at it, but it didn't matter. Like, you know, amateurism was something that was accepted at that time and even lauded. And that I found so freeing as an artist, because one of the things that I found in art school that was really hindering is that I sort of became aware of all the gestures. And when you're aware of them, and I think this is not unusual for critics, like sometimes you can become too self-conscious to make them. So this was a narrative that, even if it was like a little false, I believed it. And that was enough for me to make something. And that was really important. So one of the things I always try to communicate to people, because when I started this too, like, I didn't know anything. Like, I thought I was going to transform the writing world because, like, nobody wrote criticism that people wanted to read. Well, I didn't read any art criticism. Like, I didn't really know enough. But that naivete, again, was kind of enough to get me to do something that I might have felt too intimidated to do otherwise. So I think that that's something that is actually like really valuable to an artistic practice. It's like, it's okay to not know. I mean, obviously you want to learn, but it's okay to start from a place of not knowing, and that it takes, like, you know, whatever narrative you need that gives you the courage to do something that you wouldn't do otherwise is really important. So that is a little bit about how AFC came to being. And this is very early on. This was, I think this was the first post I ever wrote that got any attention at all. Gallery goer asked the question, what is this shit? Which, excuse me, it reads like an Onion title, but actually I was quoting a video piece which was made by MTAA, a collective duo that worked mainly online, and you can see like just a tiny bit of their installation in the screenshot below. But basically they had this this video that they had made called 10 Pre-Rejected, Pre-Approved Art Projects. And so what they had done is they had a bunch of art proposals that had all been rejected by various institutions. They pulled, they held an online poll, asked people which one they should make. Keep in mind, this is 2005. So like they had like, I don't know, 70 people fill out the poll, which is like a vast, huge number at that time. Like, yeah, and so, and also it seemed really exciting that you could do this. And then they made the performance that the audience had, the piece that the audience had voted on, which was called Midnight at the Deli. And basically that project was spend $100 at a deli and then on art materials, and then make whatever it is that you're gonna make in 24 hours. And they made, what you can't tell is they made a tinfoil Santa out of that. It looked kind of like garbage. Where I'm kind of going with this is like, what MTAA had said in their video when they were like, you know, you may be asking, what is this shit? Well, it's not just about the thing that you see. It's about the conversation we had, the whole process, the context makes this something more than it appears. And that, I thought, was really valuable because I didn't know what I was seeing. And it took a while, and that was another thing that I felt was really freeing, like to not necessarily know what you were seeing and not understand it and have that be okay, and have the process of working that out be okay. And that's something that, incidentally, has borne out in some of the studio visits, because I don't always get everything right the first time, you know? Like, sometimes you read a work and it's like, it's not right, or you get about half of it, and the conversation brings that around. So anyway, so we've done a lot of things. By 2005, I started the blog. 2010, I had interns. This is one thing that we did. Circle Glasses, the art world's gateway to power. I think if you take one thing home from this lecture today, it's that you're all failing. I don't see anybody here with circle glasses. Well, maybe, Dave, you've got almost circle glasses. You're about halfway there. Anyway, so that was one thing we did. We always prided ourselves on making art very conversational. So we would review things, and they would be in a almost like an IM format. So, you know, we'd explain what we were looking at. We'd go someplace, too. We always tried to go outside of the city. Of course, we look at art in New York, but it's important to get outside, especially because, you know, a lot of artists can't afford to live there anymore. So we'd go out and we'd just talk about art like normal people, which, as it turned out, was something that was quite revelatory at the time. And also we did like some bloggy things, like this was like, seriously, fuck you, George Basilitz. He's just a raging misogynist. And so somebody had to say that. That was a very heavily trafficked article. Anyway, I guess one of the things I wanted to get to in this talk is that pretty much all of the projects that I have made through Art of City have been inspired by things I've done through the blog, either writing about art or meeting other people, and like that kind of collaboration and like just looking at art has inspired a lot of the work, the auxiliary projects that we do, because we started out, you know, just me and my computer in what we used to call the blog mines, which was my basement. And, you know, eventually we rose out of that. But, you know, the ideas beyond the writing, we've done a lot of, for lack of a better word, art projects. And usually they were sort of conceived as either fundraisers or other ways to make money, but I think we, you know, as a collective, we think more as artists, so they never really brought in, like, tons of cash for us. Anyway, what you're looking at here is another, I think, pretty clear example of what is this shit. It's just a phone. It doesn't look like much. There's an animated GIF I made of this, which I probably should have used, but it's just like a flashing text message that says he told me to put his strap on. This particular review written by Michael Anthony Farley, I thought was really smart. So I wanted to read some of that, because this is Andrea McGinty's work. And he said of this show, which was about place, McGinty's work perhaps best illustrates the contemporary relationship to site proposed here. nomadic, small-scale gestures that are placeless and favor immediate familiarity over preciousness. I couldn't help but view these works through the lens of generational anxiety, powerlessness in the face of climate change, a nearly nomadic lifestyle as a result of gentrification, and the ever-accelerating changes in the natural and built environments. And this is another work from that show by an artist whose name I cannot pronounce properly, so we'll just look at the way it's spelled out. But this, I thought, was really kind of poignant because here, like, it is kind of relatable, right? Like, you're in this hotel room, and, like, haven't we all at some point, like, found ourselves, like, messaging somebody on Facebook or doing something online rather than, like, going out and, like, exploring our surrounding environments? And here is this, like, hotel room where, like, the internet is somehow, like, more of a place than the most placeless place there is, a motel room. So this, I thought, was definitely something that seemed specific to the, like, our contemporary context. So that really stuck with me. And then this is a slide from the Material Art Fair, which is the fair that I think is the most important fair. I'm going the wrong way. Here we are. It's the most important art fair because, like, dealers have told me that, like, this is the place that they go to find other artists. I never know exactly whether, like, how true that is, because there is a kind of narrative that sort of goes along with each fair. But in this case, like, I just really like the art vibe there too. So it seemed really an important place for artists to go because they could really find each other. And, like, the artist-run movement, which is something I'll get to a little bit later, seemed really kind of strong there. So some of the blog-specific projects that I mentioned earlier on, this is the Nine Eyes of Google Street View, which was part of an image management series that we did. So basically in 2008, keep in mind, at this time, Tumblr does not exist. You know, there's not a lot of sharing of images outside of blogs. So when I would do studio visits, I'd find that artists frequently just had, like, these folders of images that they were saving on their computers with no place to really show them. So this was the series that I started. And this was an essay by John Raffman, who's now a very well-known artist. But at the time, this was the essay that, like, kind of made him, made his name. And it was basically, he'd spent, like, I don't know, like, a year and a half, 2 years just, like, holed up in his tiny apartment in New York and in Brooklyn, like, on Google Street View and, like, various message boards and things like that, like, scouring Google Street View for these, like, just incredible images. So he talked about the kind of ethical responsibility and the kind of journalistic responsibility, the kind of art lens that you could take to this. And it was a very important essay. And I think it was like 2011 or 12. No, it was 2011. Christian Viveros Fane and Ben Davis named this body of work one of the most important works of that decade of 2000 of the aughts. So that was, you know, a big deal. This I'm gonna skip ahead, but this is a good example of one of our some of the things that we've done And this was a sound art piece that I had done. So like in 2010, I had seen a lot of art, and a lot of it made noises. And I thought it would be a very good idea to put together some of the sounds that that art made on a DJ battle record. So I made a DJ battle record. This is essentially a noise record. So, you know, it had sounds on Manhattan and Brooklyn side, and they were all kind of clips. So you might hear, for example, we had, you know, 1,000 hammers hammering nails from a like performative orchestra that was hammering nails for a score. That was on the Brooklyn side. On the Manhattan side, we had like some Lawrence Wiener poetry. So we had like everything from the kind of scrappy mom and pop like museum to the like large institutions participating in this. And then we did a Kickstarter to make all this happen. And, you know, we raised, I think it was about $12,000 to make the record. And at that time, that was a big deal. Like, I think it was one of the, like, we were very early on Kickstarter, so it was not the huge juggernaut that it is today. So this is me in a panda hat. That is going to be explained by this particular video right here. But this is another blog-specific project we've done.
Good morning, everybody. At midnight last night, for the first time in 17 years, the Republicans in Congress chose to shut down the federal government.
I opposed a government shutdown.
A faction of one party in one House of Congress, in one branch of government, shut down major parts of the government.
I think it was a mistake that President Obama and the Democrats shut the government down this fall.
Messy situation.
What everybody's going crazy about in Washington?
They shut off the panda cage.
Of course we should do something.
There's a camera, apparently, that shows the pandas in the zoo at all times. And, oh, they're so precious.
It's a disaster, and never again.
No!
A little bigger, gaining 2 pounds, now tipping the scale at 5 pounds, and can open both eyes.
So that's what we did for, I guess, 3 weeks during the government shutdown. We were dressed up like pandas every day, and we had these, we had a lot of activities, which a number of which you saw. The panda aerobics we like to do every day, that was really fun. But one of the ideas that came out of that was that maybe we could invite artists to dress up nude as pandas and make a calendar out of it. So guess what we did? We made a calendar of nude artists as pandas, and we got artist Rachel Stern to photograph. So this is an example. This is Molly Soda. So Rachel Stern made all the backgrounds for us. And this was a very popular fundraiser. We were on print magazine, published our announcement at the same time that Kim Kardashian had made the cover of something with her butt and some champagne. So we were on the internet with her on the same day that she broke the internet. Like, we had gotten tons of press. We were on, I think it was called Midnight on Comedy Central. Will Wheaton decided he didn't like our calendar. This is Martha Wilson dressed up nude as a pinup. She's great. And I think one of my greatest accomplishments, this is the staff photo. There are very few of staff, I think, that would really come together to do this. So we all pose nude for this. Because actually, as it turns out, it's really hard to find 12 artists who want to pose nude as nameless pandas. So we did the job as well. Anyway, another thing that has happened, and Mac did talk a little bit about this, is that through my time, curated projects have come up. So one of them, this happened at Denison University. It was my first show. This was it was just called Graphics Interchange Format, and so Denison had asked me to curate a show, but they had no shipping budget. So because they had no shipping budget, I was like, well, why don't we just do animated GIFs? Because in addition to having they had no shipping budget, they did have the most resourceful and interested tech guy on the planet. And so he spent 6 months just collecting old computers from different parts of the university so that we could put this show on. And so, without him, it certainly wouldn't have happened because, I really like animated GIFs quite a bit. I am not a tech wizard. So this is sort of an install view. And I tried to make the show something of a survey. So this is a piece by Kevin Buersdorf. And it's a 2008 piece, but what's a little bit difficult to tell is is the kind of virtuosity required to make a work like this. So it's a mandala, and he had this sort of belief that, you should, it was like a whole kind of religion that you could worship the banality of the web. And what he did is he pulled together all of these kind of crazy animated GIFs that are very low, small file sizes, and he put them all together. And the virtuosity here is that it's completely crisp and clean. And normally when you put, 500 different files together, it turns into this kind of fuzzy mess. And this, it has to be shown on this super high def screen. It looks beautiful, and it looks specifically GIF-y. There's a kind of crispness to the lines that is really unique to the medium. Anyway, this is another set of animated GIFs. This wasn't in this show, but we have for a long time did GIF of the day, where we would just highlight animated GIFs that we liked. And this came from a series that was run at pubs because, I think the nice thing about the internet is it, and I think the freeing element to me to some regard has been that you don't have to hold everything with this kind of preciousness and reverence that I think certain types of art require. So if you look at a kind of, you know, maybe a minimalist painting, there's a, or like a maybe Anne Truitt column, for example, there's a kind of reverence that you're expected to give to it. Whereas this work is sort of specifically made to be looked at, and probably for not nearly as long as I've just made you look at it, you know. So a bar is actually a good location for some of this work. This work with the GIF of the day had led me to another another institution had asked me to curate a GIF show. So at this point, this is a Peter Burr GIF. This is Jacoby Satterwhite. This is Giselle Zantonil. And this is Clement Valla. So these are all GIFs that were part of an exhibition at Providence College, which we called Geographically Indeterminate Fantasies. And so it's essentially, you know, to sort of boil it down, it's a landscape show, but it's like sort of fantastical landscape. So if you recall earlier on, I had talked about the show that had talked about like placelessness and preciousness, like a lack of preciousness being a thing. This was something where we started to look at these kind of constructed environments, and you know, it was very easy to also see this work as somehow like through the lens of like generational anxieties, like, you know, there is like a sort of powerlessness in the face of climate change. People do feel that there's a like shrinking public spaces. And so like when in response to that, it kind of makes sense that these like new environments are being imagined, and that sometimes they don't look that much like our own, because, you know, we, you know, need some sort of escape. So in any event, we also had a physical exhibition, and this was at Grin in Providence. And, you know, you can see one of the things that we tried to do with this exhibition was to create space through light. So this actually, I don't know if you, it's kind of hard to tell, but you can see that on that wall, there's the Giselle Zantonil piece. And then on the opposing wall, which you cannot see, there's a similar piece by her in the same shape. So what we're doing is trying to imagine like windows on the walls so that the space would look like expansive, and that there would be this sense of more space or imagined space that could take you outside, or like somehow take you outside of the walls of the gallery. And then in this particular piece, you know, you saw this was the Clement Valla that has the sort of macro and micro perspectives. And here there's the, that was on the floor, but above there's the Victoria Fu piece, which when it's working is a gesture. It's the pinching gesture that is patented by Apple that allows you to embiggen and small, like shrink something so that you can view it. So there was sort of the gesture and the kind of mechanical operation placed side by side. So we were trying to play with the sort of physical versions of these digital spaces. This is another view from the show. And then we had a screening outside of all the work. So this show existed in a physical space, but it also exists online. So if you want to see it, you can do that. And then also we did, this was a sort of itinerant project space that we did, where this was again, it sort of came out of this idea of like gentrification and shrinking spaces. So here, what we were doing looking at this entire show was artwork that was made by like queer and transgender artists who had been forced out of their spaces for various reasons and intended to focus on closed gay bars. So we had the Dyke Bar by Macon Reed. This is a terrible picture, but there's Wickerham and Lomax's. It's a kind of a hour-long video that has them like going through the streets of Baltimore. It's these like closed bars. This was John Criticello. We came here to get away from you. That was like a specific, like came from anti-gentrification protest posters. So anyway, the other thing I wanted to talk about, and this comes up quite a bit, is the role of ethics in community. And I did a bunch of, this is a panel discussion that came out of, oops. Oh, here we are, this. So in 2013, Industry City is sort of a giant complex in New York that was trying to redevelop a section of land in Brooklyn that had been used, they were renting to artists, but they wanted it to sort of become the next Chelsea Piers, like the High Line or something. So like a huge tourist trap that would make them buckets of money. So the idea was that they would get artists in to kind of give it an art cachet and then, bring in the chocolatiers and the hotels and all the rest. And so what they did is they gave artists cheap rent, but then they decided they wanted to launch a giant art show to kind of show their magnanimity and their commitment to the arts. And to do that, they kicked out all of the artists who were in the studios that they would then use for studios for this gallery show. So it was a really kind of disingenuous gesture. And so I wrote about it, and it got written up a bunch of places, and in the New York Times and all the rest. And then we did this panel discussion afterwards. That's me, and then there's Diana Renya, who is the Deputy Bureau President of Brooklyn, and Sean Gallagher, who is an artist and like city administrator, Jenny Dumnow, who runs the Artist Studio Affordability Project, who's like very focused on, working on one specific bill, and so that kind of got a lot of attention. We realized there was like definite need for education and just connection on this issue. So I organized this giant conference called Stay in New York, which would help educate artists on like all the things that they could do to secure property, do their taxes, rent, like what their rights were, what certain things they could advocate for might be. This is a section of the resource center that we had. So these were, outside of the panels, there were NYFA, the New York Foundation for the Arts, like all these different organizations that could help artists. And then this was like Art Homes. They ran with the idea that one of the problems that artists often suffer from is that they like make these big investment in renovating places that are that they don't own. So like the property value goes up and then they get kicked out and they have to sort of, they lose all their sweat equity, right? So What are some of the ways that you can hold on to that? Well, one thing is maybe you could have a trailer. So this was an idea that you could purchase a trailer. I think they cost about $6,000, and then you could keep your studio in this thing that you actually owned. So this is it was a really good idea, and it was on display at the Queens Museum. It's a little bit challenging for the city of New York. One, because there's no parking. Two, there's no electricity. So like winter months are really cold. I think those two things made it a real challenge. But they were working on getting some parking at in Far Rockaway. So, and then we also screened some movies about gentrification. And then this is the project that Mac talked about a little bit. We're so not getting our security deposit back. So this is actually what it looks like. And then this finally is what we're working on now. And I guess I kind of wanted to get to this, beyond this a little bit, but it's an art podcast that talks about the latest news and arts exhibitions through the lens of politics, money, and art. We think a lot about what the moral responsibility of artists are as citizens, in addition to their role just as artists. So we had a conversation with Kenny, which I think I'm not going to play, but Kenny Schachter is sort of a well-known character on the scene who's a wheeler and dealer. So we had him on the show because we thought maybe he'll tell us some of these secret deals, whatever they are, what are the ways that artists can get swindled, what are the ways that collectors bump up the prices on things. And he wasn't really that interested in talking about that, so we didn't get a lot of the skinny, which was a little disappointing. But Kenny Schachter is kind of known for being entertaining, so he was definitely that. So we got some art market gossip from him. Anyway, this is the last section I wanted to talk about was how we make money, because everybody always asks that. And it's, I think, kind of the... it's a nut that we haven't really fully cracked, so I might as well just be honest about that up front. So this here is a section from our annual report in 2015. Our 2018 report will look significantly different than this because I've scaled down quite a bit on the blog since 2015. But you can see that we had granting funding of, 17.5, benefit income was 60,000, individual contributions were 26,000, and other was 29. So that's basically, and you can see how it adds up there. So we had, that year, we had an operational budget of $150,000, which, let me tell you, is very small. I am one person. I had three other people working for me at the time, plus we had all the expenses. So that's it's not enough to run an organization on. And so I just want to be very clear about that, because I started AFC in 2005 and I had no expectations to make money off it. But at a certain point, these projects do have to be sustainable. And that was something that I have really struggled with and continue to struggle with. Here, this is another shot from that was a shot from a benefit video, a promo video that we made. We actually had a partnership with Sony, so they helped us make that. And you can see the individual support. So, we have quite a bit of donors at the small level, the smaller level. And anytime that I've talked to an arts administrator, they always get really excited about the volume of people that we had donating. But, you know, these are people that don't have that much money to begin with. And also, like, their resources are finite. So you can't, one of the things that we also ran into is that we had an exhausted donor base. So, and then this is Nectar Ads. So this is one, you know, under the other category, we definitely made a bunch of money from ads. The ad revenue, like I don't want it to sound like melodramatic or anything, but I do think that Facebook like kind of ruined my business model. So basically to tell you what happened, like we would make about $25,000 a year off ads. When the ad market switched, basically what happened is two things. One, we had the name Artfag City, which was really catchy, but not necessarily that friendly to sponsors or to Facebook. So, and there's another story about that too, because I did one time organize a benefit around the idea of dicks, which was actually successful. It was a real challenge. So there was that. I kept, you know, using the name Art, like we couldn't keep a Facebook page with our name. So like every time I put up a page, it would get pulled down. And that happened for maybe 2.5-3 years. And finally, I just kind of was like, all right, Art F City, like we'll drop the ag and that like we'll be able to eat a hamburger. And like that's just it. So, you know, we did have sort of people who, A, found the name offensive and didn't care that we dropped the egg. People who found the name offensive and were very happy that we dropped the egg. And people who were really upset that we dropped the egg and thought we were sellouts. So there was kind of like no winning in that. It was what it was. And then the other thing that happened is that when, you know, Facebook became a really big thing, it became harder to sell ads on the site, because what would happen is that people would find that they got better ad revenue from they got better returns from just placing an ad directly on Facebook or an Instagram. And if you're a publisher, you need people to come to your site so that they can see your ads, or you can make a sponsored post. And sponsored posts, like one, take more labor, and two, don't scale that well. So we found that we just didn't have the kind of traffic that, like, en masse, plus we didn't have a lot of Facebook followers as we would have if we didn't spend like 2 or 3 years with Facebook pulling our page off, you know? So we just like, we couldn't catch up on that. So the business model really suffered for that. And that became, a real challenge. But when we switched, or when I decided, so I kind of like burnt out because it was just taking a huge amount of energy to fundraise. And it got to the point where I kind of felt like I was fundraising for the next fundraiser. You know, I felt like I couldn't really focus on on the projects, because I was always fundraising just to stay afloat. So that didn't really work. But when I pulled back, one of the things I noticed was that, and I started doing the podcast, was a couple things. One, I was getting as much traffic for the podcast as I was for the blog, and I was doing it like a fraction of the amount of time. So there was a real shift in terms of how people would listen and or like how they were consuming media. But also the nice thing about podcasts is the ads actually work. So like the thing is when you listen to like a podcast, if you it's like it's a lot of work to kind of just get past the ads so people actually look at them. Whereas like online people have ad blockers or they, you know, they just don't see them. Like art people tend to be more savvy to begin with. But also, and then also like if this is like, if it's a time sensitive thing and you want to get people out to your event and you just have like an announcement about it on a podcast, people actually respond to that. So that was really helpful and kind of interesting. So that's one of the things that we're working on now. But we do kind of have a legacy for doing these like fun projects. So we had, this was a while back, we did the Artifact City Rob Pruitt Art Awards and Auction. And this was like the, there was the Rob Pruitt Art Awards. And I had been nominated twice for that. But we all thought it was kind of a silly award, so we made fun of it and made our own thing. And, you know, this was Nate Hill. He was giving bouncy rides. This was Andrew Andrew. We had Jennifer Catron and Paul Outlaw do all of our food and sets and stuff like that. So we had this, like, pig fountain, Jerry Saltz. We had these awards. So we online, we did like Next Best Jerry. So Jerry announced for that. And then we had a bunch of awards. And then this was the Artifact City Wienerfest and fundraiser at Postmaster's Gallery. And this was the thing where I think like perhaps bit off a little bit more than I could chew, because we had decided that I thought it'd be kind of funny to do this thing, like a wiener fest. And so like we had these, like we work with these designers who made these like weird ejaculating like hot dogs and things like that. And I really wanted Kobayashi, who was the world champion hot dog eater, to perform, because we also happened to have this, which was this like blinged out hot dog cart that we'd seen in Miami. So, but it took like quite a bit, like every bit of like administrative juice I had in me to like negotiate with, I think it was like a Ford modeling company that had sponsored this. And so they eventually just decided that they were okay with having the hot dog cart in the gallery as long as their name was not associated with it at all. So I managed to get that, and I had I flew my roommates down to Miami to pick up the hot dog cart, and they came up with a hot dog cart. And then Kobayashi was like sort of interested, because I think he had wanted to make this like switch into the art world, so he was like really interested in Jeff Koons and stuff like that, but like he's gay, and he was about to announce this like sort of machismo sports line. So his handlers were talking to me and they were like, we just don't want him to be perceived as like eating dicks. And that was like a real challenge for me to, sort of get somebody to sign on to that when I had created an entire event around the concept of eating dicks. So but it turned out he had two agents, and the one who was definitely not in favor happened to be in Hong Kong. So I scheduled it with the other guy who was in the same time zone as me. But at like 3 o'clock in the afternoon, where I knew she would be like asleep and like there was no way she could attend the meeting. I don't, by the way, recommend this as like sort of a general, like, par for the course, let's make something happen, but I really did want this to happen. So anyway, I'm talking to this guy, and he's like, oh, you know, I'm totally sympathetic to you, to these concerns, because, you know, I used to run this blog. It was called Men with Balls. I was like, great. So... So anyway, we kind of got along, and he was like, look, it's going to be fine. Like, I just don't want him photographed in front of any, you know, ejaculating hot dogs or anything. I thought, oh, well, that's great, because there's not going to be any of that, forgetting that there is this, like, anyway, it didn't really matter. I got him here, and we made this sort of victory video. We don't need to see that twice. Anyway, I would consider this one of my greater administrative victories in my career. I'd like to close with that. Although I will note that I talked to Kobayashi afterwards because I was so impressed with his, like, hot dog eating ability. And, like, prior to that, he was really kind of excited to be there because he was just, like, it was clear he really wanted to connect with the art. But once he had, like, a fangirl, he was, like, not interested. So that was the end. But anyway, does anybody have any questions about this long 13-year career? Yeah, actually, it was kind of a nuts and bolts thing, to be honest. Like, it really, it sort of started, you know, in 2008 when I won the Creative Capital grant, but because then I actually had money to do it, and I was already taking it seriously. But I think around 2009 and 2010, there was a professionalization of the web, and you were held accountable in different ways. Like, I always consider that one of the ways that I learned, I learned in public how to do all this. So when I made mistakes, people would call me out. But at a certain point, like, I don't happen to have great copy editing skills. Like, I'm super sloppy. And I've taken the courses, I've done everything I can to kind of make sure that I don't, like, spell people's names wrong, and, like, you know, I don't mix up my homonyms and things like that. And I don't have it in me. That's not my skill set. So I needed some people to work with me. And I just sort of, what happened is that I think, like, the web kind of demanded a certain professionalism, and at that time too, I wanted to give it. So I needed that staff to run the organization more professionally, and that's what happened. So it was sort of a shedding of that kind of, like eventually you do become self-conscious again, and it's not necessarily a bad thing. Well, one of the things that had happened was that I people reading the blog and like interested in our projects, I get invited to talk different places. And when I like the smaller cities, like one of the things I noticed was that like everybody was starved for criticism in a way that was just not on the same, like, in New York, you know, people will talk about like how shitty it is that they don't get written about or whatever, but they at least have the opportunity because like the art press is there. Whereas here it was like totally lacking. And whenever I went to those smaller cities, one of the things I noticed, it sort of came out of the gentrification work too, right? Because I kind of was like, AFC has always been an artist-centered blog, so like that's why we have these like art projects in addition to like, you know, regular old stuff. And so I wanted to look at the things that were affecting artists. And so when I noticed that they were moving like out of New York, I was interested in that. And then when I noticed that there was a lot of history there was no way I could ever kind of catch up on, bothered me. I was talking to, this was on one of my studio visits. I think it was like Ralph Pagoy. Is that how you say his last name? Like, oh yeah. Oh, sorry. Yeah. Like when we were talking, you had said that like you look for projects, like to make projects for things that don't already exist that you wished exist, and you make them. And that was just sort of eventually became apparent, like this was something that didn't exist that I wanted to exist, and I thought the world would be better with it. And that's why I made it. I didn't talk that much about that project, but like the thing about that project that's I think important to me is that it's more than just an exercise in nostalgia. Like I think that artist models give us things or can teach us things that we don't, like skills that maybe not everybody has, like how to navigate. They can help us, like artists likely live in communities, there's like enclaves, like they sort of naturally, I don't think that any of us are sort of happy with the gig economy and how much we get paid and that sort of thing.